Dr. Dharmadasa, I think he is one passionate but very independent-minded leader. Starting his career maybe 50 years ago as one of the clerks in his father's office, coming as the chairperson of Navaloka Holdings, today he has come a very long way. Not only covering the career life in one aspect, but in many aspects, such as sports, such as aesthetics, because once he was the chairperson for cricket board, and right now he is the chairperson for Cinec, the artistic aspect of it. So covering everything, he had done a tremendous duty to the local business. And yes, we were very privileged to have a conversation with such a versatile leader, and it is time for you to witness it.
Today we have great example for that. A leader who had done a tremendous impact to the local healthcare business in Sri Lanka. Dr. Jayanta Dharmadasa, welcome to the discussion.
Thank you.
So, as the start, can you just explain about your childhood? Have you ever had a dream to become this much of a giant businessman in Sri Lanka?
Can anybody call a giant business signal? It is just that, I mean, to answer your question, it is, I knew that I had to carry on with my father's business one day, you know. So after my A-levels, I got into the business and I was to go abroad for further, you know, studies, but I opted not to because I knew that I had to somehow, you know, one day take this over. That started my life in the business field. It was not that rosy as you think, you know. I started as a clerk in my father's office, then became the cashier, then became the chief clerk. Then I was working at the workshop where we had about 100 vehicles that time. I was the mechanic, foreman, purchasing officer. So like that, one by one, little by little, yes, came up.
Good morning, Doctor. Is there anyone significant who had tremendous influence as a leader?
I mean, nobody can have anyone's, I mean, anybody else's tremendous influence, you know. It's just that it has to come from you only, you know. But of course, with my father's living style, you know, and the business, this thing, we learned a lot from him. Maybe that is going to keep me going.
In other case, maybe as a mentor even, from the childhood itself, like you dream to become as this kind of a person?
No, never.
Okay. If sir, if Dr. Jayanta Dharmadasa, the person, if you can call him with a one word, how?
Patience.
Yes.
Okay. So, what are the most powerful decisions you all have taken during your career?
Yes, I was working with my father and my brother as the managing director in the head office. My father was the chairman and my other brother was the managing director. I had some issues with the, you know, the decision making there. So I opted to, you know, come out from the that business and to take over the hospital management.
Can you tell me about time when you almost gave up any, for any reason, you gave up something?
That was the time that I wanted to give up. That was the time that I wanted to give up because, as if I can elaborate more, I came in the company vehicle from Paliyagudu to Colombo. Then I sent the vehicle back and I had to buy a vehicle. I didn't have money to do that, you know. I put 1.5 million finance and paid 1.5 million from my whatever friend, two, three friends gave me money. I bought a locally assembled vehicle, Jeep. And I couldn't pay the first three leases. You know, the third one, they were going to seize the vehicle. So I paid the third one as the first, you know, first lease. So that was the beginning about 11 and a half years ago. It was not 40 years ago, but 11 and a half years ago. Yeah.
So, sir, so you started like that. Then, at the moment, the current economical thing in the Sri Lanka, is it favorable for the local business people, or is it not that favorable?
Currently, it's not at all favorable because there is a lot of political problems are there. Because you have to have a environment where you could just do your business, you know, not do other things in the country. But of course, when I started 11 years ago with nothing, I bought over a company which was closed down, the factory, and I managed to, within about 4 or 5 months, managed to bring it up to some level. I mean, that gave me courage and this thing to, you know, go forward. Then now I have about 24 companies. Out of the 24 companies, 9 companies are closed down companies, which I took over and now managing very well.
Okay. So with all of that, sir, what do you think about the future of healthcare industry?
No, if you talk about the healthcare in Sri Lanka, we have everything available what another country has. If we take Singapore or say India, we have everything available here, the equipment wise. And the doctors are very good. They are really trained and they know their subject. Too much government intervention, you know. The private sector has to run on its own, you know. We have to be left alone to run, you know. There can't be too many controls to this thing. That's what the other countries have flourished, you know. If you take Singapore, government has allowed them to, you know, do whatever, but they regulate. Here it's not regulate. It's just that tomorrow morning we don't know what's the next gazette going to be or the rule going to be, you know. So we are at a big disadvantage in that.
So, continues to the same question. Now, basically, government has, if governments needs to do any policies or standardizations in the healthcare business, as per your thinking, what should be the proper way of doing that? In the sense, any kind of highlighting the standards or policies?
No, standards are there. I mean, if you take the first. I mean, the main big hospitals, we have about 5. Nalwaka, Asiri, Central, Durdens, you know, like that. We have 5 big ones, private hospitals. And they are doing very well in the sense that they get the latest equipment what is available in the world. And the staff is well trained. So everything is available here. Nobody has to go out of the country to get any treatment done. Everything is available here. So government should support that, you know, without having unnecessary controls over labor or other things, you know. There are a lot of things that.
So those are the things government should not do.
They shouldn't do that. They should, I mean, it's the government has all the rights to do that, but they should discuss with the private sector and listen to our problems, you know. How we do our business, how we pay the salaries at the end of the month. They don't listen to, they don't know what we are doing.
So let's say from even our country or from other country, when they need to start a business here. So now, as per your thinking, is government is supporting them very well or government is not supporting? Let's say in Sri Lankan context.
No, I have not seen. I had about 4 big companies come into us to do business in Sri Lanka. And they were, you know, highly taken up with the setup with our management here. But after some time, they opted not to do business here. I mean, maybe other things are there, but nothing to do with the partnership or the working conditions or whatever. There may be other factors which they never told us.
So, sir, with all the problems that you have faced, so many things, so with all of that, today you are in a very good position. So, how do you influence your followers, your subordinates to follow your strategies, your vision to make this success?
I mean, one thing is, I must say, never give up. Now, if you see my life, you know, I said 11 years ago I came with nothing. But now I have, you know, I didn't do any casinos, I didn't do any other gambling, I didn't do any unwanted things. We have done what the government has done officially. You know. So people should realize that anybody can be a good entrepreneur or a good manager or businessman. If you want to do, I mean, when they go out of the country, they really work hard. But here, the labor laws are such, it's good for a, you know, first-class country. Our labor laws are the things that is keeping the people down here.
Okay, I think it's the same continuation for the last question. Now, let's say in your organization, if you're having a major conflict, do something or to do start and do something or something like that. So is there any motive factors you are just throwing to your employees as a first impression?
No, we have given them the total freedom to work here, you know. They know who the boss is and my doors are. I have told them the door is closed because the room is air conditioned. So they can walk in any time. They come for their, mostly they with their family problems, you know, and I have the time for them. And I go around, I come around 8 o'clock in the morning and I do 2-3 rounds in the hospital. So whenever somebody wants to speak to me, they speak to me, and that's what I said at the beginning, the patience, you know, I had that. We listen to them and we have the right answer for them. So that's why we don't have any unions, no labor unrest, you know. We just do our business here.
Sir, if one of your followers, one of your subordinate, or someone who is going to be a leader in tomorrow or in the future, what is your advice for them?
I don't think anyone will take my advice, but the thing is, what I practice is, what we have to do today, I do it now. Now, you wanted me to come at 10 o'clock, I came at 9:30. You know, that's the style that I work. I'm very punctual. I never disappoint anyone. If somebody wants me to come to this thing, the first day that I get invitation card or a wedding invitation or whatever, I send a letter out saying that I'm either attending or not. I don't keep them guessing, you know. Or I call them and tell them that this is, I have a small problem, I have other functions, you know, because of that I will not be able to come. So these are the things that people should practice in our day-to-day life, you know. I have not 24 hours, I have about 60 hours a day. I make it, if I go out of Colombo, I come back half a day and make it another day in office, the balance half. Now yesterday, as an example, I will tell you, yesterday I went to Gaul to see the match, Ranganas, farewell, this thing. I went there in the morning, I was there till about 1 o'clock, and I was here by about 2:15. Till about 6 I was working in the office. You know, you should never give up, you know, you have to work hard, not hard, you are not working hard, you have to do your duty.
Insightful, earnest in your younger careers. Now let's say, as the same way, if somebody wants to take the business from his father or his mother, but that person is in the younger stage, is there any secrets or any visions to be made in the younger stage itself? To know that anyway that business comes to me, but in the younger stage, is there any vision or any secret to behind to give as a example? Yes.
You shouldn't think that it is just coming to you, you know. You must think that it is yours and you have worked hard for it, you know. And you have, you know, every cent what is in that other business is yours, you know. And you have to carry on with that, not think I have got a big this thing, I can buy a Mercedes or I can go to casinos and all that. It's not the way to do things, you know. I mean, you have to just carry on the business the way it has been run or improve on it.
All the companies are talking about the commitment of the employees in these days, but in your organization, is there any particular way of giving that increase that commitment from the employee itself? Is there any leadership visions you all have already practiced?
Yeah, you have to be with them, you have to listen to them. That's what I said, again I'm using that word patience, you know. You have to listen to them, you know, each one has a different problem. If you don't know man management, you can't do your business. You know, in Sri Lanka you can never do it. So you have to have that man management, this thing. To have the man management, you have to speak to your employees, you have to be with them. I get them, we have auditorium about 200 can be packed there. So I get them in once in a way, say in once in 2 months like, even the minors, you know, and speak to them, and I ask them to come out with their problems, you know, and straight away answers are given.
And we also got to know that for your birthday, you have done a great program for the mental refreshment for the staff.
That every year I do. Every year I started with giving a lunch packet to all the employees. We have about 2,600 a year. But last few years, I've been giving a bag with rice and, you know, dal and other things which they can use for the family, you know. If you give a packet of rice, it is only for the person. This is for the entire family, they can use it. So they are very happy with those, you know.
And that's an interesting question now. I don't know whether you'll be a candidate of Navaloka group in the future. I have a small question now. Let's say you are getting two same qualified personals as one position in your group, and to select that one person from that two, is there any particular particular point where you are thinking that this characteristics is the better to the Navaloka?
You mean to take over the leadership?
Not the leadership, basically. Now let's say the two persons are coming as a candidate to a position in Navaloka, and you are going to select one. So what are the specific points where you are thinking that this person should have that kind of characteristics?
No, it depends on the subject, you know. If you are an accountant, you should know your accounts. I mean, but the thing is the loyalty.
Now let's say, sir, now both candidates are coming with the same qualifications. So then,
qualification means nothing to me, you know. I mean, there are a lot of people, now if you take even in Japan, Toyota and them, they are not educated people. But they have come up in life and the Prime Minister of Japan speak to the Toyota boss in the morning, it seems, once a week, to get some advice, you know. I know it happens here also. Some of the leaders, you know, speak to the top people here. So, I mean, it's education is a must, you know, you should have your, life in, you see. But the thing is, if you are not practical, if you don't know what you have to do, the duties what you have to do, if you don't have the loyalty to work in a place, I don't take it.
And another question, sir, as a very busy person, as you said, go out for a personal thing or to do something, you are coming back even half day to the office. So how you manage those personal life and the career life?
And tell me one person who is busy in this country. No one is busy. It's the way that you work. No one is busy. If you want to do anything, you do it. If you don't want to, you give some excuse and not do it.
That means the way of prioritizing.
Yeah, if you want to give an excuse, you just give some excuse and you don't attend it. That's what I said. Whenever I get some invitation, I call the person or I send them a letter. Tell them that I'm unable to make it. So that person also knows that I'm not coming there for that. You know. So like that, you know, you have to organize yourself. That is what is not keeping me busy. I'm not boasting of myself. I'm very well organized. You know, I do now. Even if you come to my house now, I live in the 15th floor here. I don't allow anyone to do my work. Not even the servants, not even my wife. I do everything by myself. Yeah. If you see my wardrobes, all are very clean, tidy, all by myself. So, I mean, I can say I'm a very busy person, somebody has to do that. I don't do that.
That's a good advice.
Huh? I've been doing this for years and years.
Interestingly, we came to the last question. Dr. Dharmadasa did not become as a businessman.
Yeah.
What would be the next path?
No, I told you, no. I wanted to become a businessman because father was doing a very successful business. So I wanted to be a part of that, you know. I never had any other thing in my mind. I was only going for this. But as a businessman, I did every other thing, you know. I told you, you know, the clerk's post, the cashier's post, the chief clerk's post, you know, mechanic, the foreman, you know, purchasing officer. I had done everything. Kotima kiyenawa nan, police kossage level ekken IGP vela thiyena. Rank by rank, you know, I have got. I mean, you should know all that, otherwise it is, you don't know the difficulties of the other person. I've been having my lunch with the workers, my staff, even with the mechanics, even with my laborers, you know. So I know their problems. That's why they are all with me. Most of them are here for the last 33 years. Most of them are here.
Finishing the questionnaires from here itself. Thank you very much for your valuable time to give us the support for our leadership and business development program in our MBA, Postgraduate Institute of Management, conducted by Sri Jayawardenepura University. Thank you very much for your valuable time.
Thanks very much for coming and interviewing me. I don't know whether my answers are correct for your, you know, what we are thinking, whether it's the right answers what I have given. But the thing is, I'm a very straightforward guy, I don't tell lies, you know. What is in my thing only I come out with. You will see a lot of Buddha statues, all were given by my staff. All are given by my staff, not a single thing that I have bought by myself. But I never go to a temple. That's the way that I work. Pansal gila buru karanne mam. It's in my heart. It's in my mind.
My values in my heart.
Yeah. So that's, I mean, people should learn those things, you know. Not to, you are trying to fool another person by, in return, you are the one who's getting it back. You are not trying to fool another person. You're fooling yourself. So you must be very straightforward in your dealings, whatever you do, you know. Be a friend to the others. That's what I have been to my staff here. If you come with me, you will see how they, you know, talk to me and this thing. Okay. You're welcome.